you can move the those bills forward without the housing numbers in them and leave the debate for the affordable housing ordinance. So that would be our recommendation. Then I just reminder that you do have two other plans. Thank you so much for adopting Kalihi, but you know, downtown and Ala Moana are at council. The good news is airport and Halawa are moving forward. There's going to be an airport workshop later this month. Thank you so much on behalf of all five of our departments.
Thank you very much, and thank you for all of your hard work. Members, are there any questions for the administration at this time? Councilmember Manahan? Oh, Councilmember Elefante. Sorry about that.
Thank you, Chair Pine. Administrator Rula, thank you to you and your staff and the city's Department of Planning and Permitting for all your hard work and efforts in putting this together. I could tell it's been many hours, and it's been long conversations we've had, both you and I, about which way forward and to go with our affordable housing strategy. So some key things that I did see, it's great to hear that there's the 30 years, and that if a homeowner decides to sell it within that 30-year period, it'll go back and cycle back to the 30 years. And then also the exemptions for ADUs and prior existing UAs and other exemptions that you're also keeping in there. The two concerns that I still continue to have is, one is with respect to the in-lieu fee. I know we've had numerous conversations about that, and thank you for providing that slide in terms of how the department has determined the in-lieu fee. But say, for instance, if this is the will of the council to go forward with an in-lieu fee, where would in-lieu fees be deposited to our city?
The ordinance specifies a fund. The fund would be maintained by Budget and Fiscal Services. The way the ordinance is written is the use of that fund would be, by RFP or by putting into, it could be, put into deals on some of those nine properties of city land. So that would be under the director of the Office of Strategic Development.
So it's currently an existing fund that those fees would go to, or would it be a new fund?
I think it's new, but that's ultimately up to council. Thank you. I actually want to introduce Tim Streitz. He's backing me up here. And Tim is the primary author of this ordinance. I just do have to say, when you talk about this, we've had three-hour Saturday meetings with 10 people, including Core and other folks. And then Tim and I went out and staffed a booth in Chinatown, and he emailed me the edits from that morning at 8:30 on Saturday night. So thank you, Tim. It's specified to be deposited into the Affordable Housing Development account of the Housing Development Special Fund. So it'll be a new account in the Housing Development Special Fund. But ultimately, that is up to council. We're proposing, this, and this is what BFS and admin have said this would be the best way to track it. There is language in the ordinance about how it can get used, what it can get used for, and we encourage council to look at that. Ultimately, that'll be your decision when you pass the ordinance. We think we strongly think that for developers, the in-lieu fee should be an option, because there's some projects where the developer is going to do a project that it doesn't, they're not in the business of doing the affordable housing. In some cases, their capital stack doesn't really let them say, I want to use your money, your finance money, to develop another project. They might not get the permission from their funders. So there's some cases like that where it makes sense. But given what we're reading nationally about potential cuts in affordable housing funding nationally at the federal level, we may look back and think this was a really good idea to have some additional funding that we can put in for the gap on a 60% tax credit project. How long it takes for developers, even the one on River Street, it takes a while to put that together. If you had a flexible fund that could get used to fill those gaps, we might be able to move affordable projects, ahead faster.
Okay. Thank you for that explanation. The concern I still do have with in-lieu fees is that, while I understand the challenges of developers, wanting to pencil out projects, and while there's a dire need for more affordable housing, mm-hmm. is that they use the in-lieu fee option as a way out, and mm-hmm. which is why I asked, where the funds would go if the in-lieu fees were paid. Mm-hmm. Maybe perhaps a consideration as we go through hearings, Chair, that we could maybe also look at our affordable housing fund, which was on the city, was one of the proposed charter amendments to have mixed use for basically lower AMIs, and that mm-hmm. could be an option that we could look into. Mm-hmm. And the last question I do have is, with infrastructure costs and also the building permit process. So at a recent Waipahu Town Action Plan meeting, which you were there as well, Administrator Rule, some of the concerns that were raised had to do with unimproved areas or areas that don't have drainage or sewer capacity. So infrastructure as a whole. And it's good to see that, you know, there is some incentives for sewer hookup fees, because they do hear from developers that those are some challenging costs for them to come and being passed on to the potential buyers. That does draw concern with higher costs for some of the units. So what is the city doing to find a balance with respect to infrastructure costs to provide for some of that, as well as shortening the time for our building permit process?
Sure. I may want director to come up and answer on the building permit process if you want to dig into depths about that. But for infrastructure, I think we've briefed you in the, you know, in the TOD briefings before a couple of times about our approach to infrastructure. We recently, I think partly to show our state partners how much skin in the game the city is putting in for rail, we have a five-page list of $1.2 billion in infrastructure that is planned. Not all of that is funded yet. You know, some of it is stuff that you have voted on the two-year budget. Another third of it is stuff that's in the six-year budget. So you look at those and approve those, but the funding is not, you know, final until it's in your two-year budget. And then about a third of that, 1.2, I think, is stuff that is planned. We know it needs to happen. A lot of this is the long-term sewer projects, but it's not yet in the six-year program, and so it's technically not, we don't count it as funded. There's also some of that is new, that's identified and planned for, but not really in a budget. And that's one of the reasons why, like for instance, in Ivale Kapalama, that's going to need a lot of work. So we're doing the separate infrastructure master plan and finance district study, the same strategic economics that this housing analysis is developing that study. And we're looking at and working with state agency partners to figure out how to do a finance district to maybe accelerate and come up with some additional money to accelerate it in that area. And if that works there, then we can do it in other areas of Klee, we can do it in Waipahu, they can use the same approach at Aloha Stadium.
Thank you. And maybe, Chair, at the appropriate time, can ask Acting Director Sokugawa about the building permit process.
Okay. Members, any other questions? Councilmember Manahan.
Yeah, no, I was just curious. Okay, just piggybacking on the in-lieu fees. I just feel like, you know, the in-lieu fees are too low. I understand why, you know, why they're set that way, and you know, for them to be able to supplement for perhaps another nonprofit who's trying to get their financing together. But how many inquiries have you had with the in-lieu fee that we've had? How many inquiries have we gotten from those types of developers to want to use the in-lieu fee that we have right now?
I'm so glad you asked that. I was going to get to providing that if we didn't get there. The only people who have proposed in-lieu fee as an option so far have been developers who, whether on purpose or just not understanding, have not applied it correctly. So they, you know, they said, We'll use the $45 per square foot, but only on like what would be the equivalent of the affordable or 20% of the building. And then once we let them know, no, it'll be 100% of the building. They're like, oh no, that won't work. So I would say you've seen three interim plan development permits, you know, come to council so far. There are at least five or six other projects. I'm not sure all of them will come to fruition, but they are all in the Ala Moana TOD area. And of those, every single one of them is proposing to either, the vast majority of them are proposing to put the units on site, 20%. You've been in discussions with some of them and might substitute the 15% rental, you know, which we would encourage. One of them, you know, one or two of them have put in the $45 per square foot as an option, but again, only applied it mistakenly to the affordable units. It's kind of like the proof is in the pudding. We're kind of like belt suspenders and a crutch here, you know, in terms of we had two studies look at that number and say this seems to be calibrated right. But to me, it's working when developers are choosing, as we hoped, to build the units on site rather than to pay the fee. And I would suggest you consider adopting it, you know, as is, and then if we find, you know, we get, you know, two applications that come in and they're paying the fee, and we can think maybe it's time to adjust it.
Yeah. No, the only reason I ask, Harrison, is because, you know, with the in-lieu fee assumes that, you know, there is another developer wanting to develop affordable housing, that they have some kind of financing ready, and that they also have a piece of land that they have to develop, right? So I think those are a lot of assumptions. And so my worry is that, you know, if we don't meet all those, if those assumptions are not met, then the in-lieu fee just stays in that account as an in-lieu fee, and, mm-hmm. and it's really not accessed. So, you know, maybe perhaps that's something we can look at as we work on the policy, how we can make that fund more usable,
mm-hmm.
You know, and really turn that money into units, actual mm-hmm. units. But, you know, when we looked at the price of developing an actual unit here in the urban core, at least in Waikiki, the example was in Waikiki, it comes out to about $430,000 per unit for an affordable mm-hmm. unit. So, I mean, if you're thinking, okay, $45 a square foot, doesn't seem like it would get you much. And that's why I think, you know, it's a little bit too low.
Yeah, so again, I think, you know, we're seeing some changes in structure. Thanks to Charter, we do have the new Division of Land Management Director Fund is very Akamai and experienced in actually making projects happen. You've been seeing that happen with the Housing First stuff. So once, you know, she has her team to actually help develop and move forward those 9 properties. And by the way, we have 6 or 8 for, you know, down the road that we're starting to look at that aren't quite ready. So there's more land beyond that. It would be very useful to have that in lieu fund to add to those deals. And again, you know, if it's $430,000, there are other sources. It could be a tax credit deal that, you know, has to wait for additional gap funding. So there's 2 more years. And, you know, if there's some flexibility in that fund, you can use it to make a deal happen 2 years sooner because you can close that gap.
No, I can see it coming together. That's good. Thank you. I appreciate the response.
Thank you, members. Any other questions? Well, I have a lot of questions, but I'd like to hear from a lot of the housing advocates that have come today, and then if you can just stick around, we can call you back up if that's okay.
Great.
Thank you so much. Well, we have a lot of different people that would like to give their opinion on what they just heard, and first we'll call up about 4 people and then another 4 after. We have Gavin Thornton from the Hawaii Appleseed, David Arakawa from the Land Use Research Foundation, John Wallerstrom from Forest City, Rick Cassidy from Data at Work, and then after that we'll have NIAP and some other advocates that would like to step forward. So this is kind of like a free-flowing family discussion right now. So we'd like to hear from you as advocates of what you think about this proposal. Will it create more affordable housing? Will it make things more difficult for people who do want to develop housing? And any other comments that you may have? So we'll go one by one, and then you folks can just interrupt each other if you want.
Okay, right to left or middle to
out? Doesn't matter. You can go first since you said the first word.
Does this work, by the way?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Mom.
So introduce yourself.
Ricky Cassidy. I have worked for a number of developers in the last 15 years as an independent consultant before that. I worked 4 years for Castle & Cook, 4 years for Gentry Homes before that as on the mainland. I could go on disclosing things, but what I'd like to do is talk to you as for the two people who are not in the room. One is today's buyer, and one is tomorrow's effect of this. What you're facing is a huge decision. You're at a point in history where you have tremendous opportunities and tremendous challenges, starting with the fact that 1 out of 5 people needs public rental housing. one out of five families. On top of that, number two, that family needs market rent housing. There's none of that, okay? Number three would be, the third out of the five would be, let's workforce housing. And workforce is not being done because the system was set up not to support it. If you looked at this systematically, the reason why you're in rail is because the affordable housing policy of the 90s worked so well that everybody moved out there and then you had traffic. Now you have to build rail out there because of that. My words, not yours. And on top of that, you have the cost of the rail and the ongoing responsibility of the ridership, which creates a condition everybody's looking at to use TOD as a housing as well as a transportation solution. And so you're going to want to make housing along the rail and everywhere else, especially where there's infrastructure and not where there's not, for the housing thing. To put it another way, housing's too important to be left to policy, to developers, and even to the electorate. Because if they were up here, the ones that can't buy a house or are struggling for shelter, they don't have a voice. And it's a huge voice. History has shown it's just gotten worse. History has also shown that every time there's a market upswing, there's only a small window down at the bottom where you can do affordable and workforce. This window is going to close soon. You've got interest rates. As history has shown, as the market goes up, regulations come up. The classic case was the Japanese bubble. Prices went crazy. Everybody yelled at their council member and said, what do we do? So then they did the affordable housing policy, which moved them all out to Kaple. So law of unintended consequences, or let's think through, you know, what's going to happen if this happens. So we're halfway up the cycle, somewhere like that, and HCDA and the city are proposing new rules, more rules, that sort of thing. I'm not a fan of rules. I wouldn't be a fan of rules because things change. I like knobs and dials so that if interest rates go up, something happens. My thing would be this. You have a historic opportunity to build a ton of units. Your major constituency, your partner in this is the development community. I'm not sure whether they came to you and said, this will make it easy or not. I'm pretty sure that the rules that I've just had an experience with will do that. I do have an experience that there's a lot of them, and they're calibrated. My fear is they're calibrated, to use their word, to a mainland situation. Okay? We are not the mainland. San Francisco is as close as we can get, and that's driven by high-paying jobs, guys that really want to live there and can afford it. We do not have that luxury here. We have a bunch of people, you know, in low-paying jobs. Wages have gone like this, and housing costs have gone like this, and it's a huge gap, and it's not going to get any better. The only time that housing costs come down is when you do housing supply. Then prices actually go down. So sitting in your chair, and boy, I'm glad I'm not, I would want to tell my constituents, look, we're trying our best to solve a big problem, and so please be accommodating. Ready, aim, shoot. Let's go do something. Let's not wait too long. And let's have a vision. All the hotels were built 70 to 80. You have 10 years. You could probably make a big dent in things. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Anyone else want to go next?
Sure. My name is John Wallenstrom. I'm very pleased to be here. Thank you very much. David Ray and Council Member Pine invited me, so it's nice being here, sort of. I am the developer of Kaple Lofts, which is a 500-unit apartment project. In some regards, there's another apartment project that's been built in Huaikai. So Kaple Lofts and the Huaikai project, really the only two that this state has seen. this county certainly, and I think state, has seen in a very long time in terms of a market rate apartment project, or a project that has large elements of market rate apartments. So I'd maybe throw out some observations a little bit like Ricky's. Hawaii has a wonderful cadre of tax credit apartment developers who do a wonderful job, and there's been a lot of work done to try to facilitate that. I also am speaking solely to rental projects. I don't consider myself as much an expert in for sale housing, so please don't take anything I'm saying in terms of all of the good work on for sale housing. So we have a great cadre of tax credit developers. They do proportionately exactly as many, so they do approximately as many tax credit apartments proportionately in the state of Hawaii as happens in Texas or California or Alaska or any other country, any other state, because that's largely driven by federal tax credits and tax credit policy. So we do our proportion, and we can do a lot more to help those folks build more product. That is important. We need that product. What we haven't had until the Hawaii Kai project and until Kapolei Lofts is any semblance of market rate apartments. If we were in any of the cities that that were referenced, or that Ricky just mentioned, or Harrison mentioned, we would have probably between 10 and 20% of our housing stock would be market rate apartments. Those apartments typically house young up-and-comers. You know, they're the people who drive our economy, who really make changes. If you go to San Francisco, all the Google kids are in pretty cool, sexy apartments. And say the same for Amazon kids in Seattle, or whatever was driving the DC economy. You know, that's something that exists there and is very important. And again, 10 to 20%, about 400,000 market rate apartments are produced every year. We get zero. Not zero because of what's happened recently, but we get zero. And so we have historically gotten zero. That's a societal problem, right? That's not a developer problem. That's deeper than... that is a problem. That is what drives our economy. That's a reason why our economy isn't being driven, right? Because these are the types of people, these are the kids that we bemoan going to the mainland and not coming back. Because where are they going to live? I mean, Ohana housing is terrific. That's great for some people. It's not for everybody. And my daughter's not going to live in my house. I know that. she's not going to. So that's one thing. We need to increase that. We are at a competitive disadvantage to every other city in the nation because they're delivering that type of product and we don't. And those are just the facts. And unfortunately, because I do know that we as a society need to house people who wouldn't be housed otherwise. I mean, we have to do that. So I understand there's a civic duty, I think, amongst developers, amongst certainly elected officials, amongst all of us to do that. But those price reductions impact the ability to deliver. I mean, unbelievable that our costs are higher than New York. My company is maybe the biggest developer in New York City. I can tell you we don't get the same rents, sales prices, et cetera. I mean, that's crazy that we are that expensive. So we've got to think about that one. And then the other thing, and I'd love to work more closely with Harrison. You know, I looked at one thing and data changes and shifts. But as an example, at Kapolei Lofts, we have 40% of our units are affordable to people at 140% of median. 20% of our homes are affordable at 80% of median, and then 40 are market. And I love that because that's a little, I mean, there's maybe a little bit of social engineering in there. It's a mix. We don't want to discriminate. We don't want poor people over here and rich people over there. We kind of want to mix people together. The impact of the 140% of median rents to us today, we actually, kind of as Ricky said, the devils are in the details on this stuff. Right now, we are discounting we can't get people to fill in all the paperwork. So somebody who would qualify at that rent comes in and says, and we say, okay, great, you qualify for this program, therefore sign some of these forms and do all this stuff. They actually don't do it. They would prefer to pay more to avoid the paperwork. So the economic impact to us on a per home basis is about $80,000 for a 140%, which is in the, it, Copley Lofts is big. So it's about $16 million of value that that program impacts the project. Now we signed up for it and I've got no beef. I mean, that's what we said we would do. But it has a huge impact, and it impacts the ability for me or anybody else to do another one of these things. I mean, if we had completely understood the impact of that, it throws the numbers off dramatically. So, I mean, it's tough, right? You wanna increase fees to put things in, but boy, we have a supply problem. I mean, I've been here 11 years, and I've done about 3,000 to 4,000 apartments on the mainland prior to coming here. There is no market like this. We are the most undersupplied market. I'm pretty certain in the country, and I'm relatively informed on that one. So that's enough for me.
Thank you so much. Just so we understand, when you say market rates in this area, what price point for rent and what price point for sale are you?
Not for sale.
Okay, for rent.
So a rent in New York City, usually apartment developers will talk about a price per square foot, and so in San Francisco or in New York, you're probably renting at $6 per square foot.
Okay.
So if you're building 1,000, usually smaller units, say a 500 square foot unit, you're renting that 500 square foot unit for $3,000 a month. And they can do that because they have people who have terrific jobs doing interesting things. We're $2 per square foot. So our costs, same cost, rent, divide by 3. That's how you get a loan, that's how you get finance, that's how you do those sorts of things.
So quick bottom line, you're renting out the market, you're renting out the low end, but right in between?
We're having a heck of a time having people choose to go through the paperwork process.
So they don't want their information shared, is that what it is?
Yeah, they don't want the hassle. They want to, you know, I think it's just they don't want the hassle. They don't want to have to wait 11 days to get these forms filled out and those sorts of things. So it's interesting. I mean, it's kind of an interesting social experiment. I didn't expect that. I mean, I'll fill out paperwork for $5 a month, you know, but other people won't. They were having trouble just with the processes.
Maybe you need to say you get a free meal at California Pizza Kitchen down the street or something.
No, we're given.
Whenever I mention that on my website, it gets higher volume of visits than anything I say.
$300-$400 a month in rent.
Wow.
It's a lot. It's a lot. Mm-hmm. So anyway, back to Ricky's unintended consequences. Mm-hmm. You know, gotta be careful and I would implore and just if that's the right word, don't discount how much we need. You know, it's a crisis. It is a crisis. I've never seen anything like this. I'm really happy people are jumping in on it, but man, do we need housing. None of us, myself included, don't bemoan the fact that your kid isn't going to come back home. I'm going to bemoan that. That's going to be a total bummer. But what is my daughter going to do? Where is she going to live? We need to supply housing for those people. So, I got to shut up or put up. And, you know, I think that we got to get this stuff going. And so,
thank you so much.
You're welcome.
You know, my name is Dave Arakawa. I'm with Land Use Research Foundation, and our members are 23 of the large landowners, developers, and a major utility, Hawaiian Electric. But first, I'd like to start off with John's company, Forest City, is a member of LRF, but I'd like to ask John, what would you do if you had to do it all over again, Kapolei Lofts, and how would you have structured it? That would help both the council and that would help the city.
So that's interesting. I think in Kapolei Lofts, I would. So Kapolei Lofts is tricky. That is really tricky. The way that thing got financed is really tricky. So the way that we financed, and thanks to the city and to the state, we couldn't have gotten it done but for working with both the city and the state. We accepted. I said I have no beef. We accepted lower rent levels in order to receive, truthfully, both a GET exemption and a property tax exemption. So we said, we'll do these things, we'll get that. That's part of what made it financeable. That's one of 10 different pieces. There are a lot of, we did a big PV deal, so we have income from energy. You know, there's a lot of other tricks we used or methods we used. Which is really ironic because it just said, and I really agree with Ricky. I think the regulation is tough on us. But right now, I didn't expect people to not sign up at 140 for this program. So I could have done a different proportion in there, had the same results, and come out the other end. But probably because I've got too big of an ego, I wouldn't do that much differently. I kind of like the way it turned out. So,
and your land cost was very exceptional. Right?
No, people. That's a urban myth. Ask the Campbell guys.
Okay.
Campbell guys are going to do just fine. And so yeah, Campbell's going to make our Kapolei properties is going to do just fine.
Okay. Well, with respect to LRF and what LRF is looking at. We think that this new policy is a step in the right direction. It includes a lot of incentives. It includes flexibility. The one thing that we look forward to in working with the city and the administration and the various departments and the council is having the actual people who do housing. That's why I asked John Wallenstrom. Have the developers who actually do housing and get their input. It's great and all to have, to quote mainland studies or have a mainland consultant, but I used to work for this attorney, Wally Fujiyama, and he used to say, you know what, if those experts were so smart, they'd be millionaires, right? They'd be developing. And so that's the idea. And same thing, we appreciate all the hard work of the city staff, but if they knew how to build affordable housing and housing for a lot of people, the city would be doing that as a business and you'd have a lot more city projects, affordable housing projects done. The people who know how to do it are the developers. So this is the first meeting, good start. We don't even have the policy in writing, but just some general thoughts about it. The general thought is that not only would you need to consult with experts in housing, but financial experts, financing experts. So consulting people like UHERO on the economics, but Hawaii Bankers Association, Honolulu Board of Realtors, Hawaii Mortgage Bankers Association, those types of organizations can tell you whether a 30-year affordability on a for-sale home makes sense, right? Whether right of first refusal for the county will work, right? Whether those units will be marketable, those types of issues. So very, very important. We need to commend the city for their incentives. They've been very creative, and they've dug deep to look at the incentives for building. So that's a step in the right direction. The other issue, elephant in the room, I guess, is infrastructure. And that depends on the council budget and the city administration priorities, but sewer infrastructure, as you folks know from the ADU issue, right? Sewer infrastructure stops even the approval of ADU units, right? And Councilmember Elefante has been at the IA Neighborhood Board meeting where he's heard all this. And so to the extent we can all work together, including the landowners, including the developers, but primarily the city and county on sewer infrastructure. I understand for the Iwale-Kapalama area, the state is even involved. So state is willing to work on it. But looking at ways to finance infrastructure, because all this doesn't matter if you don't have sewer capacity or water capacity or roads or whatever you need, right? You know, so that's the big elephant in the room. You need the infrastructure capacity first. So all these plans are great, but they're just going to say no go because you don't have sewer capacity. The next issue would be, I guess, the 30-year affordability requirement. And it was mentioned, I think Harrison mentioned the Maui affordable housing requirement. It was passed in 2006, and it was repealed in the last week of December in 2014. Last week in December, so it was in effect for 8 years. There was only one project under that affordable housing, and same thing. You know, we went there, we testified, we said, please listen to the developers. Please listen to people who actually build it. Nope, they wanted to do their own thing. They put in a 50% affordable housing requirement, 25 years restriction. Only one project signed up in 8 years. Only one project signed up. Only three houses in 8 years. Three houses were sold under that policy at affordable housing rates. 14 houses were actually built under that as affordable, but 11 had to be sold to market because, you know, they couldn't sell it to people in that income level. They couldn't qualify. Only three in 8 years under that policy. So what did they do? They took that 25-year restriction. They didn't have 30. They had 25-year, okay? And they reduced it to 10 years. And they took that 50% required, 50% of your total number of units, they reduced it to 25%. They cut it in half. And now it's working. I don't have the latest on how many projects are getting approved, but it's starting to work. Honolulu is a very different market from Maui, given, but I think the message there was second time around when they revised it in December of 2014, they actually listened to the people who build housing, the people, the realtors, the mortgage people, so they actually listened. And so while it's great to have mainland consultants, I think, you know, it's a step in the right direction that you and the city administration and Harrison and DPP are talking to the local housing advocates and the local housing developers. The other thing too, when I say talk to the experienced housing developers, the housing advocates are just as important and need a seat at the table. Mm-hmm. You know, people like FACE, people like Hawaii Appleseed, you know, they keep everybody on the straight and narrow, so they're very important too. The second thing is the issue about the changing the level of affordability and deleting 120 to 140% AMI. Right now, affordable housing across the state, okay, HUD uses 140% and below of area median income as their top limit, and it goes all the way down 120, 100, 80, you know, and 60 and lower. HUD uses it, the feds use it, the state uses it, HHFDC uses 140 and below, Maui uses it, every island, Kauai uses it, you know, every island, every county uses it. And what this policy is doing, I think the intent is good to serve a lower, concentrate on a lower area of income, but you're cutting out these people that make 120% to 140%. They don't qualify for these affordable housing projects. And where are they going to go? You're throwing them in and making them compete with the market. So, you know, we'd like to see some movement on that. You know, last time I came, I think I used the Toyota hypothetical. If the city is going to require you to build all of these Corollas, and you're losing money for every Corolla you build, right? You're going to have to build, or you're going to have to produce Lexuses to make up for the loss. Then nobody builds Camrys. Nobody builds Camrys for the middle class. So in that 120 to 140 and above, we're looking at, these are the Camry people maybe, or the higher end Corolla people and Camry people. So we say, please save that level of affordability. the fifth thing is that they didn't get to it, but I hope that the ordinance and the policy includes some discretion for the director of planning and permitting or the housing director. And the reason why is these off-site and on-site and in lieu fees, Councilmember Elefante and Councilmember Monahan talked about in lieu fees. Perhaps they might want to use, the county city might want to use those in lieu fees to support a project near an employment center. It's not on-site, but it's near an employment center. So, but they would be, under this policy, they'd be penalized by doing so, even though that's where the housing should go. So giving the director that kind of discretion might be a good thing. And you could make the director do findings or whatever it is. But giving the director, and that's what they did on Maui. On Maui, they amended the law to give the director discretion in those areas. So those are some of the things. I guess the last thing would, with respect to this policy, and we haven't seen it, would be that perhaps the policy should have a way to check it, you know, every 2 years or every so many years to measure, to have some measure of metrics so we can see how we're doing, you know. So those are our, you know, basic comments with respect to the policy. But the idea of having this hearing and the city administration opening up and you know, having meetings with the developers is a great thing. Mm-hmm. Again, Hawaii is a very different place from places on the mainland, so I'll just close it. Please listen. You don't have to take 100%, but we would appreciate if they look to the experience of the people who actually build homes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Can I interrupt? Just yes. Do you mind? I thought of one thing when you were talking about discretion, which is so important. One of the ways that Kapolei lofts work is the city has certain requirements and the state has requirements, and those didn't match completely. But as we satisfy the city requirement, these are incorrect numbers, but the city requires, well, correct numbers. City requires 20% of the units to be affordable at 80% of median. State required different things, but 60% of the units needed to be affordable at 140 and below. So we satisfied both through the 60%. The state gave us credit for the 80% of median that we provided to the city. What would be important for a developer, because there is, I have heard, and don't have direct experience with this, there's an agency right now that's saying, well, I don't care what the city is requiring, you've got to do what I want to do, additive. So instead of, in my example, I'd suddenly have to do 80% of the units because I'd have to do the city's 20 and the state's 60, mm-hmm. and we would not have the housing. We would not have received the housing if that were the case. So it's kind of hard to ever want to subject yourself to somebody else's whim, but in the event that your percentages were satisfied by a state requirement, then that would be important. And in the event that you got credits or other things, you would still need to receive those as well. And I don't know enough about this, so I want to be a little careful, but I've heard that HCDA right now is requiring a developer to do on addition. So basically, in the case of Kapolei Lofts, it would have been 80% of the homes, and there'd be no project. So if you guys could subordinate yourselves to other requirements, that would be great, because you're getting the same thing achieved. You know, you'll get the same result. Just allow the other group's requirements to trump, I suppose.
Thank you very much. Okay.
And I'm Gavin Thornton from Hawaii Appleseed. I want to echo everybody's thanks. It's so great to be here and be part of this conversation. And I think the inclusionary conversation that David was talking about is very important. I was actually involved in some of the discussions relating to these affordability requirements that Harrison Rood led, that involved that expert, and there were folks from the community, from the developer community, involved in that, and I think provided a lot of information that the expert analysis from the mainland was based on. So I think that's an important consideration. I also heard loud and clear during those meetings that there were a lot of people that from the developer side that didn't really like the inclusionary zoning requirements, the affordability requirements, and had concerns about those. And in fact, there's a UHERO report from 2010 that says that 90% of studies on inclusionary zoning have found that they actually suppress development, that they don't lead to development of affordable housing units. And so that's something that I've heard brought up frequently, but I don't agree with that. There have been other studies that have come out. Most recently, I think it's called the Housing Council in 2016, talked about how with more valid studies than all the ones that were considered in the UHERO one, they have shown that in areas where there are high housing costs and a strong housing market, inclusionary zoning can be an effective way of developing affordable housing units. And I think maybe it was John that mentioned, you know, the devil is in the details there. Obviously, with the 50% requirement that Maui had, like that's just a non-starter. That's not going to work. That's going to do the opposite of what you want to do. These requirements, like I think the lowest one is 5% for rentals outside of the TOD zones. I mean, those seem a lot more reasonable. I do not have the financing background to figure all that stuff out, but I do have some degree of confidence in the folks at Strategic Economics that did that analysis to try and figure out, you know, really looking for the sweet spot of how do we get affordable housing units built. And that's another thing I'd like to emphasize. It's not just that there's a demand for more housing. There's a demand for more housing at certain segments of the market, and the majority of that demand is at 80% of AMI or below. I don't have great concerns about building for the like 140%. I'm not worried about that because there's actually been a more recent housing study that's come out in late 2016. I think Harrison showed a slide from the 2011 study. The more recent study actually shows greater demand for the lower income folks. And so I think that's an important thing to take into consideration as well. And then the last thing I want to really highlight is the opportunity that we're provided with transit-oriented development here. Massive public investment in the rail, billions of public dollars spent on that. And it's my understanding that, you know, that raises the values of the properties around the rail stations, right? Like people, I would pay more to live closer to a rail station. So that value is created by these community dollars. And then on top of that, you have the opportunity to build higher, build more densely. You also have the opportunity to waive parking requirements. Parking is very expensive. I understand it's between like $30,000 and $50,000 per parking space. So I know when the Mauna Alana development was coming through, that was an issue. I think they had like 270 some parking units waived. That's worth like $8.5 million, between $8.5 million and $13 some million. So I think that represents a significant opportunity that, frankly, I'm concerned about being squandered. Like I really think it's important that we focus on that. I don't think anyone minds that benefit being shared, but I think it really is important that the community gets a fair share of what they've invested to create that additional value.
Well, thank you very much, and I'd like to hear from some other people that have been waiting to testify that may need to leave, and if your folks are still in the audience, we might call you back up. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
So if the NIAP guys can come up, maybe some FACE people, I see you, or OHA, if you want to step forward. You're okay? Okay. If you can just identify yourselves for the council members. Thank you so much, Professor. I'm going to call you.
My name is Chris Duker. I'm with NAIOP Hawaii. I'm also a developer in Honolulu. I want to thank you for the invitation, Chair Pine and other committee members to be here. I, too, want to echo some of the comments that were said earlier. I think that, I appreciate staff and the building department's efforts on this. It is a monumental task, to be sure, and something does need to be done. Honolulu is in a huge housing crisis. There's no question about that. And I think probably the most important thing that council and the administration will be working on in this next 6 months to a year, whatever it is this issue. It can have huge repercussions, good or bad, depending on how it's executed. I think that, I look forward to seeing the plan, but I have very grave concerns about portions of it. I think there is definitely something that can be done, to be sure, but I would emphasize and ask that this committee and the council really approach this. These are extremely complex, home building, home development. Development in general is a very complex subject, and even myself, who is in the industry at times, can find things, easy to glass over. So I would encourage you to, when looking and evaluating at these, to really approach it from a common sense standpoint and sort of step back and keep it simple to a certain extent, because it's easy to get lost in a lot of the details. However, the details of the policy are very important. So I look forward to seeing the policy, in its entirety, and I think at that time we'd love to come back and comment and give our input. Myself as a developer, growing up here, having children here, I have grave concerns about Hawaii in terms of our housing and in terms of if my children will be able to come back. And it's something that will affect the quality of our life, for generations. I think there's a huge opportunity here in light of, the city's commitment to build the rail, and that certainly shouldn't be squandered, but the goal is to create more housing, and particularly affordable, but housing in general. And I agree on the 140 and below is direly needed, but certainly all of the segments within there are direly needed. And so I'd like to leave you with one comment, though. I think it's important to, again, in the common sense standpoint, to look at this crisis almost as a famine. If people are starving and they need food, I don't think it's a good idea to make it tougher for the farmer to grow food. Now, that's not to say we don't need some kind of a policy that works and provides for some of the areas that aren't the easiest to provide. But again, I just stress looking at things with a very simple, common sense way when you're approaching these complex subjects. So, Scott.
Thanks, Chris.
Hi, my name is Scott Settle, and I'm the president of NAIOP Hawaii for 2017. I'm also an affordable housing attorney and work on development and financing of many projects. Mostly when you talk about affordable housing, we're thinking about projects that are tax credit driven, and they serve groups that earning 60% or below the median. One of the reasons why we have so much trouble and such a crisis above that is there is no subsidy for it, really. I mean, there's sometimes a little bit of tax, real property tax abatement. You might be able to get some GET relief in building it if you do certain things with HHFDC, but it's very complicated, very time-consuming and costly, primarily you're not seeing anything above 60% or any significant amount of rentals, at least above 60%, because there's no subsidy. So I think that it's important to have a policy that encourages and focuses on the development of affordable 140, 120, whatever, and below to serve that gap. Maybe I'm not convinced, but maybe that can be helped with exactions or inclusionary zoning. But I think it hasn't really worked to date. So I kind of agree with Chris. You have to be very careful when you do this. What I think we're being asked to do is enter into an experiment based on studies. And if we're going to do that and you want to take the risk of doing that, then I think you need to give yourselves an out. We need to maybe say, hey, let's try this where maybe it might work in Ala Moana, Kapi'olani corridor and test it. Did it produce more housing? Did it work or did it not? As opposed to, you know, just going island wide and hoping that something's going to happen. I think you got to give yourselves an ability to test and measure. I think that's really important. And then I guess the bottom line is I would encourage, as opposed to just relying on studies, that you speak with folks like Chris or any of the other members of NIAP Hawaii, which, you know, most of the developers in town are members of, and work with folks like John Wallenstrom and the people that are going to be tasked to actually build this housing. I think it's very, very important that you talk to them, because they will tell you whether they can build or not. And we worked hard on that with Harrison on that study. We provided him a lot of information, and what his study, in my opinion, came back with was that this won't work unless it's on Kapi'olani or Ala Moana in that corridor, where there's enough availability of market or a very luxury type price housing to offset the losses that a developer is going to suffer to build the lower. And we were talking about $150,000 or more per unit of loss, and no developer is going to build that unless there's he can make it up on the higher end, which leads projects to be low end and high end, you know, the haves and the have nots. But I think more importantly, in going back to what John was saying, is we really have a societal problem on affordable housing. So if that's really the case, I don't think you can force a developer to do it. What you've got to do is incentivize, and we've got to kind of, as a community, decide that this really is a crisis, not just say it's a crisis, but do something about it. To me, that means figuring out a way to raise subsidy and money to incentivize the actual building of housing. There's a lot of these tricks, extra density, give waiver of sewer fees, all that helps, and it adds a little bit to it, but it's just not enough. I think Chris will agree with me that the gap is too great. You have to subsidize that if you want to build that kind of housing.
I would just add, I agree with everything Scott's saying. From 120% of median income to 140, in today's market, it's pretty, you can provide that kind of housing. You look at Marshall Hung's project in Kaka'ako, and there's others like that. When you get below 120, and particularly when you get down to 80, or anything above 60 to 120, it's very difficult, and it's exponentially difficult the further you go down. The bottom line is, in most cases, you need money that you cannot get from state or federal tax credits. And so there's nothing in place now to provide that shortfall. Except to Harrison's point, the staff's point, and the study's point, their numbers show that it made sense in the Ala Moana area. And then hence the reason for staggering, you know, the time frame. But I would ask, in 2 years or in 4 years, does anybody anticipate that the property values in Iwale or Pearl Ridge area are going to be that much higher or as close as they are in Ala Moana to make development make sense? I don't think so. Maybe at some point in time in the future when the rail is up and running, but there's some other logical flaws I have issues with in the study, and I think, you know, that we can talk about those and work through them. But I would also ask you, the 30 years, is it better to provide 1,000 units, let's pick a number, that are affordable for 30 years, or is it better to provide 3,000 units that are available for 10? I mean, the bottom line is, I mean, great, it'd be great to have 3,000 at 30 years, but it's going to be a lot easier and more realistic, in my mind, to provide them for 10 years and create more. These are things I think, again, I'd ask just to step back and logically try and approach this from, you know, something that makes sense. And look at the historical data in Honolulu. We already have a program in place, the 201H program, both at the state and the city level. Most developers move forward on the state level because it's less restrictive on the affordable housing requirements. And you haven't seen a tremendous amount of affordable housing that comes out of that. And they give density waivers on sewer, all of the things that we're, well, maybe not on sewer, but all of the things that we're talking about. And you haven't seen a lot of development from that. So it's not just an issue of, hey, we'll give you density, we'll waive the fees. Maybe in the Alamoana area, but for Eveleigh or Pearl City or some of these other areas, we're spending $10+ billion to build this piece. And if we don't build the housing around it, what are we doing it for?
Thank you.
So yeah, I really appreciate it. And again, just encourage you, if you have questions or you don't understand the economics or how this is actually going to work, is how many units are going to be built, you know, please, you know, contact us so we can get you in touch with the developers. And you can hear from them on whether, hey, if we do this, are you going to build? I think that's most important question for you folks to ask.
I'd just like to add one thing, too. Most of the developers that were involved in this working with the city, and there's a great deal of effort, and I do very much appreciate Harrison and the staff's and the administration's work on this, because it is a huge issue.